Good morning.
Good morning.
If any of you are visitors this morning, we want to give you a warm welcome to worship with us here at Pastor Lutheran on this Sunday. And so you know what the rest of people know, I am not the regular one here. I am just a fill-in for today, a member of the congregation, but we are a congregation in transition right now. So they need to look around for people like me who can step in during that time here for this morning. But we welcome all of you to worship here this morning. A couple of announcements have been asked to underscore. One is in our bulletin, and we want to all be aware of that next Sunday, October 30th, we have an opportunity as a congregation to thank Pastor Pam for her ministry with us and also to wish her well on her next adventures in life as she and her family go forward from here. So I hope that people will then bring your cards if you have any for this next Sunday. We can leave them here in the narthex. Also, for next Sunday, we'll have cake and ice cream after worship as a way to gather together in support for Pastor Pam on that Sunday.
I believe it's just cake and coffee, Larry. I don't think there's ice cream.
Oh, okay, just cake and coffee. So if you really got your hopes up with what I said, bring some ice cream. But as it stands, it's going to be cake and coffee. Yeah, okay. And one other announcement I was asked to make, that Mary Winter asked if I would let you know. We have a person who is a senior citizen, been coming to our church and worshiping here. This Sunday is not here, but lives in Custer, and needs a ride from this person's house to the store after church. So if anybody could help with that, if you would check with Mary following worship, she'll let you know how to contact that person. They'd appreciate a ride to the market here in Custer. And then Barb has an announcement for us too.
I'm sure you all noticed the wonderful items we have out there. This is Sharing the Dream from Guatemala, fair trade crafts that they make down there. I'm wearing one of their jackets that we don't get clothes anymore, but beautiful things. And Sharing the Dream in Guatemala supports school kids, they support elders, they do wonderful work down there. And I know Phil and I support one elder, and I'm not sure how much it is a year. It's not very much. And that's for an elder's housing, their food, and their medicine. It's a wonderful way to support artisans who are working to get things for their people. The head store is in Vermilion, and now they have another store in Sioux Falls. And I haven't checked online if you can get clothes online, but we appreciate all of you being out there shopping. We'll be there today, Wednesday, and next Sunday. So thank you for your support.
Thanks,
yeah. I'd invite you to stand for our sharing of the peace and also for our opening hymn, if you would. Peace of the Lord be with you now and always.
And also with you.
Please share the peace with others this month.
God's peace.
Thank you.
Indeed, are many, and we have sinned against you. O hope of Israel, its Savior in time of trouble, why should you be like a stranger in the land, like a traveler turning aside for the night? Why should you be like someone confused, like a mighty warrior who cannot get help? Yet you, O Lord, are in the midst of us, and we are called by your name. Do not forsake us. Thus says the Lord concerning this people. Truly, they have loved to wander. They have not restrained their feet. Therefore, the Lord does not accept them. Now he will remember their iniquity and punish their sins. Have you completely rejected Judah? Does your heart loathe Zion? Why have you struck us down so that there is no healing for us? We look for peace but find no good, for a time of healing, but there is terror instead. We acknowledge our wickedness, O Lord, the iniquity of our ancestors, for we have sinned against you. Do not spurn us for your name's sake. Do not dishonor your glorious throne. Remember and do not break your covenant with us. Can any idols of the nation bring rain? Or can the heavens give showers? Is it not you, O Lord our God? We set our hope on you, for it is you who do all this. Join me in reading responsibly from Psalm 84. How dear to me is your dwelling, O Lord of hosts.
My soul has a desire and longing for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh rejoice in the living God.
Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest, where she may lay her young by the side of your altars. O Lord of hosts, my King and my God.
Happy are they who dwell in your house. They will always be praising you.
Happy are the people whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on the pilgrim's way.
Those who go through the walls and valley will find a place of springs, for the early rains have covered it with pools of water.
They will climb from height to height, and the God of gods will be seen in Zion. The second reading comes from 2 Timothy, the 4th chapter. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. At my first defense, no one came to my support, but all deserted me. May it not be counted against them. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed, and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Here ends the reading.
Hey, Mark. There's one song we forgot to put in the bulletin. It's Mark's birthday today. Suppose he has a song for us to sing.
Hey,
Mary Winter is getting even. leave, and this morning she sang to me, and I asked her what she did with the money, and she said, "What money?" And I said, "The money your mother gave you for singing lessons."
Do we have any children that are looking to come up for children's message this morning, or are we ready for going to the message this morning? Oh, good. Kate's going to give me a chance. I just wanted to be sure I hadn't just skipped this, right, Kate? Well, I tell you, I would bet if you're a bit like me, and I think you probably are, kind of like stories, right? Yeah. People tell stories for a couple of reasons. One is because they want us to remember it. When I was a kid, it's a long time ago, but I still remember this. I had two sisters at home, and where I lived, the bus had to come out in the country to pick us up for school. And I remember, I thought it would be a funny joke. So I said to my sisters, "Bus is coming, the bus is coming." And they ran downstairs, hurried everything, they weren't half ready yet. I said, "The bus isn't coming." And I did that another day. And my mother took me aside and said, "You shouldn't do that. People will not believe you when it's really important." And they told me you could be standing in the street in town and say, "A car's coming." "Oh, it really isn't." And they won't believe me. And they could step out and come close to getting hit. So be careful when you tell a story that it really is true when you say something. Well, our Bible verse this morning has a story that Jesus told. And he told it because he heard some people talking. He was walking on the street, and he heard people just talking. And some were saying, "I am really, really happy with myself because I am so smart. I am so good. I have so many things going well for me. I'm not like those people, that group of people, and those people over there." And Jesus told people, he wanted to tell them some important things, a little story. And he told them this story. You see, he wanted to know that God hears all conversation. So he made it this story. He says, two people came to pray. One came and his prayer was all about himself. And he said, "I am so thankful, I am so wonderful, I am so great, I know so much, everything's so good for me. And I'm glad I'm not like some other people," and named some other people. The second person came to pray and he talked about himself too. And he said, "I really feel down today, I feel weak, I feel I have little to nothing to give. I don't feel like I'm very proud of where I am today, and I need help." And Jesus said, "That's the one I can reach down and embrace and be there with them and to help that person." I think Jesus wanted us to remember that story and find ourselves in the story so that we too might be conscious of when people are feeling down and help them, that we might know that God does not like to hear us making ourselves better than someone else. And two things very important, I think, for us to remember in that story. That's why he told us the story. Now, we could forget the story, but God gives us God's Spirit to always remind us of that story and to listen to what we say and other people are saying. So let's share it in prayer, asking for God to help us remember. Gracious God, we thank you for the stories that you tell and for people like the writer of the Gospel of Luke who remember those stories and tell them to us. Help us, O God, to remember this story and to remember to reach out to people who feel down and out like you did in the story. And help us also to know not to be the kind of people who think we're so much better than others and look down on other people. With your Spirit's help, O God, we can be the people you call for us to be. In thy name, Lord, we pray. Amen. Thanks, Kate.
you, O Lord.
Jesus told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all of my income. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even look up to heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. Word of God, word of life.
Praise you, O Christ.
In this gospel, the writer of Luke wants to be sure that we understand what prompted Jesus to tell this story. And so he tells us that Jesus, walking around in the marketplace, listened to conversation going on around him. And listening to that conversation, heard something that very much disturbed Jesus. For he heard people talking as though they were so righteous, always right. Everything about them was so much better than some others they saw as people who did not think like them, believe like them, or have the same sort of goals as they did, and they looked down on these people. And so two things concern Jesus here. That people would be so self-righteous, so self-centered, and that they could look down on anyone who was not like them. And so Jesus decided to tell a story. Now, I believe Jesus told stories because, like me, and probably like you as well, we remember a story better than if someone just gives us a talk. And so Jesus told a story. And the hope in telling the story is that the listeners, the people in that time that Jesus told the story, and people like you and me today, we will find ourselves in the story. Now, there's three places I think we can find ourselves. We can find ourselves as the one who is very proud and talking very big about all the wonderful things about themselves. And to tell you the truth, I'm not going to ask you to admit to this, and I'll drink a little adjustment here, but there are times I have done that. And at times then I will realize, after being so conscious that I was going to be right all the way through, discover I was wrong. It's an embarrassing thing, but it's also not a thing one should be doing, especially if it leads to looking down on everyone who disagrees. But there's a third party in the story. The one who is carefully listening to the conversation going on around them and takes that conversation seriously. Our God listens to that conversation, and I believe in this story is inviting us to listen to what's being said around us, and to be that voice of God at those times. For we know how important it is to not be judgmental to other people and to treat all people fairly. We teach that to our children. We know, but we expect the teachers in school, if children from the very elementary grades up through high school, if they hear them say something in a derogatory way about another student or a group of students or anyone in the school, they will reprimand them for that. They will say, we don't talk that way in this school. That's not appropriate for us to be talking like that. We have staff come to our camp at Outlaw Ranch every summer. And they come for staff training. A big part of our staff training is making sure they know what we expect of how they treat fellow staff and how they treat every camper who comes to that camp. To treat them with respect, to not look down on anybody and make sure no one else within the camp family does that either. You could probably ask any of our high school youth who went into the community of trust and looking for a job this summer. Their employees expected the same of them. No matter who might be the customer you're dealing with, we expect you to be respectful to them. No matter what their race may be, their age may be, their size may be, their economic standing may be, we expect you to treat them equally. It's a high value of us. That's why we make sure our children know that. People who work for us know that. I was thinking about this text last Tuesday when we met with our social ministry committee here at Custer Lutheran Fellowship. I told them in thinking about this text, there was something that just really was disturbing me inside, and I needed to talk with them about it, and I was glad for that group when I could share this concern. I told them, it really bothers me at times as I listen in this year, a political year going on, and all the comments I hear degrading people, individuals, and speaking down to whole groups of people. And I think, where's the voice of the church? When did we start letting this be normal, a way that we could function? I wonder, what do our youth think of us? That we can go along and talk like this and be this kind of people and think nothing more should be expected of us. How do we find our voice again? So they might look to us and say, this isn't something we expect, that we somehow have a higher standard of value of a person who works at Subway than we do who goes to Pier or to Washington, D.C. It seems to me we should hold the same standard. And so I told them what I felt I needed to do. And I would like to see us, maybe if we would, as a social ministries committee, I have decided what my voice means the most is to the people who I already respect and support them because of their party, whatever, and listen carefully to what they're saying. And if they say anything in a derogatory way about the person they are running against or a whole party on the opposite side of the aisle from them, I need to say something. That's not the way I look for society to function as a Christian. Friday of this week, I got a letter from someone who I do respect, who I support them in many of the things that they support. And they wrote in their email to me, like oftentimes they do, proud of different legislation that they had passed. And then they went on to say, which I've heard said before and said nothing about it. How if it wasn't for the people on the other side who do nothing good, how they're always so far out of it. And so I wrote back to them the next morning and said, I appreciate you being in touch with me and keeping me informed. I'm grateful for what you were able to do in a bipartisan way. It lets me know you're talking with each other, and I am grateful for that. But I have a problem with your closing statements. We have talked, I told them, at our social ministries committee at Custer Lutheran Fellowship, how this is disturbing to us. It is not the way our Lord wants us to be as a people, as a nation. And I know that our God takes an interest in all conversation, whether in prayer or whether in the public area. And so I need to tell you, it disturbs me that you would talk categorically about everyone who doesn't agree with you as though somehow they can be degraded and set aside. I don't think we can continue doing that. I think we need to find our voice in whichever party we are speaking to most often and let them know that is never appropriate. It is not the way our God looks for us to function as a people. We need to remember this story and find our voice. And maybe then young people will see it's not just when they're in high school. It's not just when they're serving food at the local store or helping gas. We don't do that anymore, I guess, but helping out the gas station, whatever they're doing. That sometimes we hold a higher standard to what we expect of them. there's a goal to represent us in pure ordinary sea. They can expect, they have a right to expect more of us than that. And I think we need to do it. I would hope that as a committee, as a congregation, and if I could be so bold as to dream that big, as a church all across the state and the nation would start saying, we remember a story that is important for us to remember. And so wherever it may be, in our local level, in our own school, in our own local businesses, in our own interaction with people, or on the larger plane, we do not want to hear people speaking of themselves as so right and everyone else is so wrong, degrading other people for whatever reason. And it just may be, if we find our voice, remember the story, and remember that in times God wants us to be that listening ear, and remembering the story he told, you're going to let people know this is what our God expects of us. It may be that if we can remember the story and we can speak in that way, that the young people in our community will begin to think that maybe we are moving ever closer to what we pledge, that we really could be one nation under God. Amen.
Thank you.
invite you to share with me in our prayers of the people. God of mercy, you are in the midst of us and we are called by your name. Inspire your church to serve and love all people with the unceasing grace you extend to us. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all creation, you formed a world where even the sparrow finds a home. Preserve the beauty and diversity of all creatures with whom we share the earth. Lead us to protect all living things. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of peace, you are an ever-present help in time of trouble. Rescue families and nations torn about by violence and warfare. We think especially this morning of those living in the country of Ukraine. We ask, O God, to be with them, whether present in their homeland or now in another land, waiting to return. Unite all people toward common goals of reconciliation and peace for every person. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of hope, you stand with the suffering and give strength. Comfort your people filled with fear or anger, anxiety or shame. Bring healing to all who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of restoration, you call us to trust in you and not ourselves alone. Make this congregation a community of humility and repentance, ready to encounter you in love and follow in your ways. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of eternal life, to you be the glory forever. We give you thanks for all who have fought the good fight, finished the race, kept the faith, and now live with you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
With grateful hearts, we commend our spoken and silent prayers to you, O God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll receive our offering at this time.
You never meant to walk this road alone. we're gonna make it home. Someday soon 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 we're gonna make it home. Gonna make it home. Weary travel, restless soul. You were never meant to walk this road alone.
And the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Peace with Christ beside you.
Thanks be to God.